Hello and welcome to our special pre-budget series, Ideas for India. This budget will probably rest on four major pillars. One, its fiscal balance. Two, its approach to banks. Three, its infrastructure push. And four, its effort to relieve rural distress. Today we discuss the king of all budget themes, the fiscal balance. The key question we are asking today is, should the budget stick to a fiscal deficit of 3.5% of GDP? Those in favor have argued that 3.5% ought to have been reached this year, FY16 itself. We are already late by 1 year if we reach it next year. This year, the states too will borrow more money. And finally, we may not get the advantage of low crude oil prices next year that we have got this year. Hence, must meet 3.5% this year. Those who want fiscal largesse point out to the anemic growth in India and the world, the fact that world over, governments are being goaded to spend and that fiscal excess wisely invested is better than a number-driven stinginess. Well, there is much at stake on both sides, so we have a star panel for you. Rakesh Mohan, eminent economist, former Reserve Bank of India Deputy Governor, Jahangir Aziz, Chief Economist, JP Morgan, and Sonal Verma, Chief Economist, Nomura. Gentlemen and lady, welcome to the show. Let me start with you, Dr. Mohan, as a person who, when you wore your IMF hat, saw a lot of other economies grappling with similar problems. How sacred should that 3.5% target be?
I'll speak somewhat with a forked tongue in the sense that I think it is indeed important for the government to provide credibility to its fiscal programs so that once they set targets, it's important that the world at large understands that our government means business in terms of keeping to targets and keeping fiscal prudence as among the top objectives of fiscal policy. Having said that, I would, however, say that it is important to give a greater focus on the quality of expenditure and the composition of expenditure. It does seem to me that at the current time, when private investment in India is indeed lagging, given the stressed balance sheets of many of the large segments of the corporate sector and the corresponding stressed balance sheets of banks, the likelihood of private investment reviving in the coming fiscal year does not seem to be very high.
Yes.
And therefore, it's very important for the government to really step up public investment in a credible and transparent fashion. So it is in that context that what I would say is that it's important that the government provide a clear program of public investment in roads, in the railways, in health, in urban infrastructure, and so on, in ports, and so on, both public and private. But particularly in the public investment. But the important point here is that they need to do this in a transparent fashion to say that, look, last year we spent so much in public investment. This year we're going to spend so much in public investment and provide evidence of a big push. And also, of course, set up the implementation procedures.
Okay.
If they're able to do that, then corresponding with that, one needs to look at the revenue sources for such increases in public investment. And that could indeed be either through the IIFCL as off-budget borrowing.
Okay.
Or I would even say that one could suggest that there should be special infrastructure bonds floated by the government,
okay,
whose proceeds go into a public account, which is non-lapsable, and whose proceeds are only used for public investment.
Okay.
There would be no different from any other bonds, but they should be labeled as infrastructure bonds, whose proceeds get separated from the rest of the budget.
Fair point. Okay, so that's a couple of ideas. One, that the deficit can be reneged on, provided it is for investment purposes, and then some off-balance sheet money raising. But Dr. Mohan, just one more very brief question before I go to the others. What is forgivable in the form of fiscal largesse? Not 3.5. Would you be okay with 3.6, 3.7, 3.8, 3.9?
I don't really want to focus on a particular number. As I said, what is more important are the actual public investment figures and credibility in being able to make their investment in a public investment in the infrastructure sector.
Now, I still want to tie you down, sir. 3.9 or 3.7, there is a wide difference. If it is 3.9 or 4, you have not adjusted at all. If it is 3.7, you have shown
You're not going to succeed in tying me down since I'm an independent person now. So let me just add one more point, actually. That we do have a tax GDP ratio that is low by any standards, that is lower than comparable economies with similar per capita incomes. Mm. And so we also need to focus much more on revenue raising in order to increase public investment.
Jahangir, what would your number be? And I really want a number. I think credibility is very different if it is 3.5 and if it is 3.9. What kind of a fiscal deficit should the government come out with?
3.5.
Okay. And your argument would be?
Because anything else is incredulous. Last year, as you pointed out, the government said, well, this year we are in a pretty bad shape. We need to support the economy, so let's not go the full distance of fiscal consolidation. But next year we will do it. Mm. Here comes next year. We are going to say, well, not really. The world is still very pretty weak. I'm going to do it next year. Mm. The question that it raises is that if at $30 a barrel, that this government cannot consolidate 0.5 percentage point of GDP, when can it? Okay. And it isn't that the government did not have the revenue. It had 0.5 percentage point of windfall gain from lower than expected oil, this thing, which they completely taxed it away. So the fiscal management was not that they didn't have revenue. It's just that they had revenue. They simply did not want to use the other revenue shortfall. I mean, privatization, for example, wasn't completed. So the fiscal management this year was pretty baffling. Because if they had actually passed on that 0.5 percentage point of excise taxes to consumers, even RBI would say that by their own estimates, the average inflation rate would be at least about 100 basis points lower. By the RBI's own logic, the RBI would be cutting repo rates by another 100 basis points. So here we are stuck in a world in which we did not really get any growth advantage. We have higher inflation, we have higher interest rates, and even the stock market wasn't buffered by the very, very inexplicable fiscal management of last year. So I know Dr. Mohan is talking about credibility, but there is no real credibility if they keep on doing the same things as they did last year without changing the framework.
All right. I'll come back to the off-balance sheet ideas that Dr. Mohan has thrown in a minute. But let me get Sona Lin on which side of the debate she is. Dr. Mohan won't mind something higher than 3.5, which I think to be substantial should be closer to 3.9. Jahangir is at 3.5. What's your advice, Sona?
Yeah, I think, one needs to do a cost-benefit analysis of, slipping versus not slipping. And the question is the reason why we are slipping. Clearly it's important to consolidate and we also need public investment in infrastructure. But actually the FRBM came into effect in 2003 and we are still struggling to get to 3% of GDP. And the reason why we are debating a slip this year is not because of CAPEX, but it's actually because of the pay commission. Which is going to add almost 0.7% of GDP pay commission and the one rank, one pension. So the quality of spending that's really going to happen on the balance sheet in FY17 is not going to be so much pro-capital expenditure as, we are making it out to be here. And second is the fact that the, we've been focusing so much on the central fiscal deficit, but the state deficits are also expected to actually expand in the next couple of years because of their own implementation of the pay commission and the Uday interest payments that they have to make. And therefore, the aggregate borrowing, even by the state government, is actually growing quite rapidly. And therefore, the total borrowing by the general government is actually quite large and large relative to the total demand that we are seeing. So what we do not want is the benefit that we think we will get out of these stimulus actually ends up being completely offset by the costs that we impose on the economy because of, again, giving out a consumption-led stimulus, partly crowding out other investments, which in any case are suffering. So at this stage, I think there's no debate that India needs more public investment in infrastructure. But if it is off balance sheet, yes. If it can be financed through new revenue sources, yes, why not? But if it's going to come at the cost of slipping on the fiscal front, at this stage, I think the costs are probably more than the benefits.
Okay. Dr. Mohan, at the moment, you're one versus two people preferring fiscal discipline. They would prefer off balance sheet and more revenues, newer tax revenues. We will debate both that in a minute with our guests. Have to take a mandatory break. Welcome back to our pre-budget special Ideas for India. Today we are discussing the most important idea for the Indian budget, whether the fiscal balance should be maintained at 3.5% fiscal deficit or whether growth requirements need push the government to renege on that and go to perhaps a higher fiscal deficit. Well, Dr. Mohan, to come back with, to you once again. Sonal left off the argument by saying that state government, state governments are also going to produce a higher fiscal deficit in FY17 because they have to fund the power reforms. A month ago and even a few weeks ago, the state governments were unable to sell their state development loans, even without the excess. The spread with Government of India paper, which normally was 25 basis, went up to 40 basis. So state governments are borrowing at a heavy price. Given that, do you think that there is appetite for more government bonds, even if there is a very good justification? Let me go with a 3.8% fiscal deficit. That will mean a government borrowing program which will be at least 25% more than what it is estimated for FY16. Will it not come at yields of over 8%? Then will it be worth it?
I would then, however, again say that given these circumstances, with the global economy being in the state that it's in, the IMF has been revising downwards its predictions, its forecasts for global economic growth consistently, if I remember correctly, for the last 3 years. Each and every forecast has been revised downwards. Second, in terms of being able to keep to commitments, etc., remember that the huge monetary policy stimulus through unconventional monetary policies in the United States, in Europe, in Japan, their expectations in terms of recovery of the global economy have been belied. So given these conditions where the kind of forecasts that the IMF has been making for the global economy, the kind of expectations the central banks of the Federal Reserve, the ECB, the Bank of Japan have been making, which have not fructified, that it's not surprising that some of our forecasts also don't get fructified. So in that sense, we are in a special situation in the global economy. And so if there is something that the government can do in a credible fashion, both combining the resource raising side, both in terms of off budget, also as I said, even on budget, that if you segregate the funds raised from infrastructure bonds, even on budget, not off budget, but credibly in a separate account, which only goes to infrastructure investment, it does seem to me that if you do that communication properly, if you do the implementation properly, then it does seem to me that the market will not react as badly as it might if you just raise the fiscal deficit without giving that kind of information and that kind of implementation commitments.
Well, Dr. Mohan, let me persist with this for a bit more. Like I told you, the appetite was not there this year. The only way the Reserve Bank, this time it was a 5.15 lakh crore net borrowing. And in FY17, it might well be northwards of 5.4 lakh crore if the fiscal deficit came in at probably 3.8-3.9% of the GDP. Now, the point is, the only way this can keep the yields below 8% is if RBI bought more bonds, did more open market operations, expanded its balance sheet. That is, for me, it looks like the only way out. Is that what you want?
No, what I would say in the context of the expansion of the Reserve Bank balance sheet, that the expansion of the Reserve Bank balance sheet should be proportionate to the expansion of the expected growth in the economy as a whole. while keeping
sir, that's
M0,
what it is, sir, this year. Sir, that is what it is this year.
I'm sorry?
This year, reserve money growth is 11.3%. Nominal GDP actually in the first 9 months is not even in double digits. So actually, even the current year's OMO and reserve money creation is over 11%, 11.3%. Next year, if you have to account for a higher bond buying, then we will be way above nominal GDP. Are you okay with that?
No. As I'm saying, see, these are not one-to-one relationships, and they vary. So, only thing I would say is that the Reserve Bank does need to make sure that the expansion of its balance sheet is consistent with the kind of monetary program that it would like to have. It should not do excessive expansion. I'm very clear on that. It should not do excessive expansion of the balance sheet. But nonetheless, these are not one-to-one relationships. Those things that you have to make some certain judgments on what is feasible, what is credible, and what is prudent. So I certainly would not say that, look, the Reserve Bank should go all out to expand the balance sheet so that the government's borrowing program gets done on a reasonable basis. The government does need to get market signals in terms of the cost of any kind of higher borrowing. So I would not want to do that. But nonetheless, I do think that you need to maintain a certain desirable growth of the Reserve Bank balance sheet that is consistent with its monetary program.
Fair enough. Well, Jahangir, you know, this investment capex by the government to ensure GDP because nobody else is investing. You know, what is the total capital expenditure? On non-plan side, it is about 1 trillion rupees, actually less than that, estimated FY16. And plan expenditure is another 1.3 lakh crore. 2.3 lakh crore is about 2% of the GDP. Does it really amount to a huge push to the GDP growth, 2 lakh crore rupees?
No, it doesn't. And I will also disagree that this is a time when we should be pushing for infrastructure investment. I know infrastructure investment is motherhood and apple pie, but almost every corporate will tell you that the reason why they're not expanding is there is no visibility of sustainable demand. And that's where corporate investment is stuck. It's not because the government is not crowding in corporate investment by doing a little bit more of public investment. We tried that this year. What happened? The corporates just shrugged it off and they walked away. We need to figure out what is an alternative sustainable source of demand. And the alternative source of demand, if it has to be consumption, domestic consumption, then the structure of public finance needs to change. You can't go on spending on infrastructure. You need to start spending on things where the private sector has a huge amount of spending out of pocket, which is health and education. Where the largest amount of precautionary savings is done by Indian household is in children's education and in their own retirement health. That's the place where the investment has to take place. That's where the expenditure has to grow, not buildings of, you know, a few more ports. I mean, it's not going to do very much.
I take your point. Jahangir, you know, we are running out of time, so quickly, Sonal, the other point that both you and Dr. Mohan alluded to is the off-balance sheet raising of money, which can help. But wouldn't that also come at a much higher interest rate if government bonds within the fiscal deficit limit are themselves being raised at 7.95% today? Off-balance sheet money will come more expensive. Is this really an idea that will work?
I think other than, you know, raising more bonds, what I also had in mind was, financing also by public sector companies. You mentioned, Lata, that the aggregate capex by the central government is only about 1.7% of GDP. You're right, it's quite low. But if you add up the capex by state governments and public sector companies, aggregate is actually closer to 5.5% to 6% of GDP. So I think with center and state a bit constrained, there will be, in my view, a greater reliance on public sector companies to do capex. Second is, leveraging on the National Infrastructure Investment Fund, which was, visioned last year. So if the fund can get more money from the sovereign wealth funds or can, government puts in some equity and then the fund raises some debt and can finance some of the infrastructure projects, that might not necessarily have a negative impact on the bond market. And third, also, greater reliance on some of the, offshore funding, sources of funding. For instance, Japan, for some of our projects, has lent long-term money at very low interest rates. So if we can tie up for long-term funding at lower interest rates from some foreign sources, then we might not see the crowding out that we are, fearing at this stage.
All right. Well, actually, out of time, but not out of ideas, definitely. This is a star panel, and it has come with a lot of disagreement, but with a lot of agreement as well. Dr. Mohan, Sonal, Jahangir, thank you very much for joining me. Well, the key takeaways, there is still a lot of debate on whether the fiscal deficit should be kept at 3.5%. Two people in favor of keeping the deficit at 3.5%, one no. I would add my weight to the people who say that it should be at 3.5%. So at the moment, the majority is with fiscal prudence. But within that, the investment avenues itself, there is a lot of disagreement. Dr. Mohan preferring more investment in infrastructure and roads and rails and ports, and Jahangir preferring that the investment come in services. So those are two very important ideas from this panel. And more importantly, raising the pie itself through new means. Dr. Mohan referred to newer way of taxing. We are still a very, very undertaxed country if you looked at tax to GDP and off balance sheet money that can be raised, especially as Sonal pointed out, through the NIIF, tying up long-term funds with multilateral bodies. Divestment and privatization is an area that we have not yet thought about, though at this point in time, resource companies which are with the public sector perhaps will not fit in much. A fourth point that I could not raise, bank recapitalization. Probably if banks are recapitalized, the government might, with a smaller amount of money, get a larger growth multiplier than if it tried to spend the money itself. A larger role for the banks. That will be the idea that we will discuss in our next edition of Ideas for India. Thank you very much for watching this one.